Surprised to see the 18 toward the front.
Meanwhile, Erik Jones, who has the second fastest lap of this session, has spun in turn two, backed it up almost to the wall. Don't believe he touched it.
Mike, it was an interesting spin because I watched him as he went into turn one. The car just started to step out, and it just got worse and worse and worse, and finally it came all the way around. You see him here. He's loose. He's spinning. Drives that thing all the way around to the back straightaway.
For a second there, DW, I thought he was in a drifting competition.
That's what it looked like.
And he did bang the left rear corner into the wall.
Yeah, just a tad.
Tiny bit of damage there.
Race fans, it's time for the most famous words in motorsports. Please welcome local Toyota owner from Haley Toyota, Devon Smith, to give the command.
Drivers, start your engines.
Served at Richmond, we're underway in the Commonwealth.
What a great start to 21 had, but he's got to check that bottom from Daniel Suarez there. He's going to try to send it in there. And look at him go to the top already.
Whoa, they're already three wide off turn two, and it's a couple of cars together. Brennan Poole got into the left rear of Benjamin.
Anxious times for the kid making his career debut. Hemric jumps out front, Suarez behind him, and a gaggle off of turn four. What a mess.
And right now they're saying, welcome to the big leagues. That is a tough spot to be in for your first lap in Xfinity race to be three wide in the middle.
And that's why I talked in the pre-race show. I said, they're going to be three, maybe even four wide. I know a bunch of fans were thinking, come on, Mike, they're not going to be three or four wide. Already on lap one, three wide. Looking to go
able to get around Ryan Blaney. That's big as far as picking up some points at the end of stage one. And this is big as well. 19 left of your screen. Last car on the lead lap. Austin Dillon trying to put him a lap down. And there you saw Ryan Blaney right of your screen, kissing the wall down
just
the back straight away.
Just hits it fine. It's good.
Last lap, stage one. Can the 19 of Matt Tisch stay on the lead lap? Good battle for position here. Final spot inside the top 10 for Poole and William Byron. Here we come back to the green and white checkered flag. Austin Dillon goes high. Matt Tift in the blue 19 stays low. He will remain on the lead lap, and your stage one winner is Austin Dillon. Second place goes to Justin Allgaier. Daniel Hemric will be third. Those two qualify for the Dash for Cash in our final stage. Rounding out the top five, Ty Dillon and the young kid, Kyle Benjamin, who fell to eighth at the start, came back to be inside the top five. Kyle Larson, Daniel Suarez, Elliott Sadler, Ryan Blaney, and William Byron, your top 10 in stage one. Austin Dillon has one short track win in his Xfinity Series career. Came at Bristol last August, off to a great start today here in Richmond, a couple of days after his 27th birthday.
Position for Elliott Sadler.
Oh, there's the yellow. Back down there.
That's the 28 of Dakota Armstrong. Second caution of the day. First caused by an incident on track. Our other came at the end of stage one.
You talked about
that's
you don't
the
know.
Caution for Casey Mears right there.
Bank on the fact that we're going to run those final 100 laps caution free.
See what happened to the 28 of Dakota Armstrong here.
I don't want to go to the bank on that.
Woo. He looked like he just got loose in.
And that's a great job keeping out of that outside wall. But that tells you right there, that's a perfect picture. Perfect picture of what loose end looks like, huh, Joey?
Yeah, especially I think you said he didn't have any brakes, which it looks like he's got some. But once they start to go away here, it's tough, and you're pumping them up trying to get in the corner, and you don't know the way the bias bars are on these things that you might get the front before the back or the rear before you get the front brake, and it sets the car loose right off the bat, and then it gets hard to catch it. But
all right, and a good day for Kyle Benjamin. He's going to restart sixth here.
Let me ask you something. You having fun?
Having fun. It's definitely a good time.
I hear you. You ain't too hot there, are you?
It's a little toasty.
That's all right. You're young. We can cook you a little bit. You'll last.
10-4.
I'm glad they asked him if he's having fun now as compared to after that first start of the day when we went green. Huh? Track is hot, slick. So let's crank it up here on a Saturday afternoon at Richmond International Raceway.
Clear. Sure.
We got the brake heat going. It's better for him.
Series regular is able to win a stage. Seen it twice this season, actually four times. Elliott Sadler got a couple of them at Daytona. We've seen two in the last couple of races. Justin Allgaier joining that group. He wins stage two. Second is Austin Dillon. Larson, Ty Dillon, and Hemric the top five. And the battle for that final transfer spot in the dash for cash goes to Elliott Sadler. He outruns Brennan Poole back to the green and white checkered flag. The other driver advancing and eligible for the dash for cash in our final stage today, Kyle Benjamin, the 19-year-old out of Easley, South Carolina. Allgaier, your leader.
We're complaining about loose conditions, and Brendan Gaughan, he hits the wall early on lap 19, makes brief contact with the 98 of Casey.
Gave up ninth in the running order to get fresh tires and problems for BJ McLeod. Is it going to bring out our fifth caution of the day? He gets below the yellow line, and there it is. Yellow flag is out, and now decision time with 12 laps to go, likely going to be 10 or less when we open up pit road. Do you come here, Larry? You got to come get these tires, right?
Absolutely. It's not even decision time in my book.
I'm going to add a lap here, so it's going to be, it's like six laps to go.
Kyle Benjamin back on pit road. Looks like they had a penalty. I'm hearing from the pit road that there was an uncontrolled tire from this car. We talked about the money stop, top 10 all day long, and watch this.
And there you see the tire go out the...
Oh, maybe he left too soon. Was maybe they didn't have the left rear lug?
I don't think they had the lugs on it, and they come back in to put the lugs back on.
Look here on the left side. It looks like to me that the tire actually moved, like maybe he put it in gear right there, or didn't have his foot on the brake for the tire changer, and it moved just a little bit. Chris? Yes.
Adam, you can see that he leaves a little bit too early there. The car, the left side of the car was still up in the air, and you can see that the jack falls over there, and then that left rear tire comes off.
Kyle Larson's going to make a big run here. Look at him already setting back off the three, and what a weird restart that was.
Five laps to go. Seven was sideways. Three-car Ty Dillon jumps out front, and there goes Kyle Larson as well. Allgaier winding it up in that outside lane. He's dominated today, leading 157 laps, but he's trapped as we come back to four laps remaining at Richmond. And we got trouble. Daniel Suarez off of turn four slid up into the outside wall. Damage for Harrison Rhodes in the 20. Kyle Benjamin, 48 of Brennan Poole, also sitting down on the apron.
Well, we talked about the money stop and not making any mistakes. We saw a mistake by Kyle Benjamin, the kid making his Xfinity debut, and look at the result of it. He's in a crash lately.
So he knew he had to play defense on the restart.
Looks like William Byron into the back of the 18 car Suarez, and watch what happens after that. Brennan Poole trying to slip through. The 0-1 of Harrison Rhodes with contact.
Clear light.
He just got turned.
Yeah, the way William Byron went up the racetrack, it almost looked like something broke or had a flat tire because it went straight up the racetrack.
Yeah,
you can see he goes straight
wall.
Into the wall even afterwards. So I think something may have happened to that nine car.
By Credit One Bank, here we go.
Justin Allgaier gets a good start here. He's going to be right on his door into the corner.
Oh, but Allgaier slips up, and a great turn by Larson. Will they get off turn two without crashing?
Hemric up to third.
No!
They're by the overtime line. No caution yet. Larson is out front. Caution is out now. Larson leading. Allgaier are going to finish second. The white flag was in the air. No, we see the caution lights are on. They're waving the white flag,
nope.
But not the caution and the white together. So the caution was out. We freeze the field. Kyle Larson was the race leader at the time of caution. Justin Allgaier was second. So Larson is going to collect his second victory of 2017. And Allgaier Allgaier is going to finish second and win the dash for cash. And both of them sped up coming back to the official checkered flag there, because I think everybody was just a little bit confused about what had happened, maybe.
Well, it was, because the caution lights came on, but the flag man just had a white flag, so, and they call the caution from the tower. So I think there's a little confusion with the flags that they saw, and they thought maybe we should still race. Who knows?
He didn't lead many laps, but he led the right one.
Right here, watch that. There's the overtime line. He crosses it, and we'll watch for the caution light.
I don't know if we can see it from this angle.
There it is.
Oh, there it is. Oh, okay. All right. Oh, we kind of missed it. We're going to try to circle out.
Here we are. So we said it. Once the race leader crosses the overtime line on the opening lap of the two-lap shootout, caution comes out, we freeze the field. And when we did that, it was Kyle Larson leading. Frustration for Justin Allgaier, who led 157 laps today, but is going to record a second-place finish and not get win number two in 2017.
Man, look at that energy.
I don't know what he's talking about. He's definitely angry, and as he should be. It's such a fast car, had a great shot at winning the race. He did a great job. I don't know what he's talking to NASCAR about there.
Maybe when they tell him he's won $100,000, he'll feel better.
I don't know. It helps a little
bit,
but man, you want to go to victory lane with some trophies and all. This is going to be bittersweet for him.
Chris, let's go to you.
Well, Shannon, he definitely is a bit frustrated down here, but he got a $100,000 check at Phoenix, and he's going to get another $100,000 check from Comcast here today. So that's going to feel a little bit good, Justin. But how did that last lap play out?
You know, first of all, hats off to Xfinity, Comcast, Father Eufra Sport. So win $100,000 dash for cash. I mean, obviously, this is something that we set out to do when we got here this weekend. And unfortunately, there at the end, the best car doesn't always win the race, and this brand freshener agriculture Chevy was awesome today, and I really hate it for the guys, because we got the restart before the last one, we got one taken away from us, and unfortunately there at the end, then, you know, there was so much confusion on that last green white checkered that the caution lights were on, but we were still racing back to the line. It's just really, really disappointing. These guys at Dream Motorsports don't deserve that. And again, just hats off to these guys and the crew. They did a great job all weekend. All of our partners at Dream Motorsports, Hendrick Engine, Chevy, just everybody that's a part of this race team. It's been really, really fun. And, it's bittersweet today. I'll be honest with you. It's very bittersweet. And I'm very dejected. I won't lie to you. But, that one hurts. That's going to hurt for a long time. But huge thank you, to everybody on this team. Pit crew did an awesome job. Thank you.
Thanks, Justin. Shannon?
Kyle Larson climbs from his Camaro and celebrates in victory lane at Richmond. His second win of the season. Kyle says he's not very good at this racetrack, but he looked pretty good there at the end. You didn't lead many, but you led the one that counted most. How'd you do it on that last restart?
Ty took off early that one restart. And I don't know if I was clear or not down the backstretch, but anyways, he jumped the start, so I was able to. Hey, thanks. I was able to be the leader for that last restart. Justin took off way better than I had wanted him to, and I'm surprised I cleared him off too, because I thought he would hang on my outside, if not past me, and like he did to Austin earlier in the race. And thankfully, we were able to clear him in the crash, and they threw the caution. And got the overtime win. So didn't have the best car at all. Justin was by far the best. Then I felt like Ty was probably next best. And then me and Austin were pretty even. So Credit One Bank Chevy, though, was good enough to be in contention to win. And we got the job done. So pit crew and the whole crew, everybody at the shop did a great job. And I'm not good at this place. So to get a win's pretty neat.
What do you learn for tomorrow?
For tomorrow, just being patient. You know, I still got to work on myself for long runs. I'm terrible on long runs, and was okay today, but tomorrow the competition's a lot harder, and drivers are better. So just got to be patient, struggle within happy hour. So we'll see how we are tomorrow.
He parked it. Kyle Larson wins at Richmond.
Race fans, it's time for the most famous words in motorsports. Here to give the command for today's Toyota Owners 400, welcome loyal Toyota owner from Priority Toyota of Richmond, Major Eric Phillips.
Drivers, start your engines.
Slick. Biggity, biggity, biggity. Let's go racing, drivers.
Slick is the word. It's near 90 degrees. That'll be the high for today. Full sunshine, a few small clouds. We're going to be slip sliding around this place. Track temp already up.
Yeah, look at that, Mike. 123 degrees. These cars are not going to have a lot of grip, especially if you're further back. I mean, those up front, like Matt Kenseth, yeah, they got nice clean air. Look at sparks already flying off some of the cars. Yeah, there's so little tire grip here under braking, cornering, and accelerating. It's really going to test these drivers' ability. 77 of Eric Jones got a little bit of the wall coming off of turn two.
Let's show it to you.
Yeah, he's back here.
Right.
That wasn't bad. Typically see some pretty decent green, long green flag runs.
77 in the wall,
77, Eric Jones.
I mean, that car went straight.
Car never turned coming to the corner.
No, it never did. Come down the back. Had a flat. He was running 20th.
We saw him brush the wall on lap one, but we're told he cut a left front tire.
Well, did he? He probably made contact with somebody else on the left side and cut that left front tire.
Yeah, maybe when he got into the wall, he bounced off that wall and got into somebody. And I guess he cut down left front tire, sounds like.
Oh, he already realizes there's something wrong. You can see the high line he's taking in there.
That tire's down.
Tried to get it slowed down, little wiggle, straight in the wall.
Heavy contact. Saw the front of the car rear up in the air. That means he hit the wall a ton. Oof. And the car is pretty much destroyed.
Contact. Looking down at the lower right corner.
Casey Kane made contact.
Yeah.
A little bit to the left front from the right rear, Casey Kane. I don't know if Eric tried to go three wide or if Casey Kane went into the middle to make it three wide, but somehow they got three wide and there just wasn't enough room off of turn two.
Chris Neville, and here's Chris Neville.
And 2 weeks in a row, Eric Jones finds the wall. Eric, good to see you're okay. What happened there?
I got ran right in the wall on lap one. We're three wide on lap one of a 400 lap race. And the five just squeezed me into the fence off of two and was doing all I could not to wreck all of us. And apparently we got a tire cut after that, blew a left front going into three and destroyed our race car. So it's really unfortunate. Made three laps or whatever. And, we're loaded up and going home. So it's disappointing. I think we had a pretty good car, but we'll just have to come back next week stronger.
Kurt Busch has had trouble all weekend. They had electrical problems in practice. First a spark plug wire, then they thought a battery problem, and now this.
Toolbox working, 14.0 on volts. They said try to shut it off and then re-crank the cool box, see if it'll reset itself. 10.4, already tried.
Ooh, that's not going to go over very well. I was already talking about how hot it is. It's not only hot, it's very humid. And on days like that, now he'll have fluid, so hopefully, and that will certainly help keep him hydrated, but you want that air box blowing some air around inside that car.
For second place, car in the wall, turn four, Stenhouse might have had a little help as he battled Denny Hamlin for position.
These two have been going at it, battling.
They've been racing really, really hard, that little group right there, and Stenhouse been right out against that wall last several laps.
Racing for seventh place down the backstretch.
Oh boy, yeah, just looked like Stenhouse got in there a little hot, got a little bit loose, stepped out, couldn't catch it. There's a great angle.
Yeah, there was, I don't think there was contact.
Come on, clear, all clear.
Boy, nice job of Denny by staying off Ricky Stenhouse.
Yeah, I don't think so. No contact.
I do think there's a little bit of a domino effect. Yeah, here we go on with Kyle Larson. I think he got in the back of, oh, not really. I thought he got into the back of Dale Earnhardt Jr., but not at all.
If he wanted a race, let's race, but what an idiot.
Well, okay, write that down. That's our first idiot of the day.
We've been watching this battle.
And we're told Kyle Busch made some contact back there.
No, he made a lot of contact. Oh. he was all over the place there for a few laps.
So he gets a big run off the top. Ooh, that's how you cut a left rear tire down or a right front tire, is that kind of contact.
Denny Hamlin knocking on the door of Kevin Harvick.
Hamlin is trying to get one more spot.
And for the first time since stage one back in Daytona in February, Joe Gibbs Racing wins stage one.
Boy, Larson also making a big run to the outside. Can he make this stick and get the momentum off of turn four?
It'll be a little bit of a drag race here between the 42, but I believe he's got the momentum. Oh, I think the 78 made it. No, they said Larson got him.
So all the way back to Joey Logano in 10th place coming to the line. Here's the race for second place at the line.
Wow, it was close.
That looked like that Daytona finish from where Denny Hamlin beat Martin Truex by the same margin. Stage one is history. Matt Kenseth the winner. Benedetto got the free pass, so we restart with 28 cars on the lead lap through the Geico restart zone, and we're back under green.
I believe Kenseth's going to have his hands full now, Mike. I believe that 42 car can maybe get up there, run that high line, and give Kenseth a little bit of a run.
Yeah, we've seen the 42 of Larson be pretty good on short runs and long runs.
But man, just look at that. The one thing that Matt Kenseth has got going for him, forward bite. That car jumps up off the corner.
Kyle Busch, high, wide, and handsome. Here he comes.
Oh, he got a little
high, a little too high.
Two to go, stage two.
Man, there's just battles all over the place for position. Try not to go lap down.
When it comes
so
into
much
these,
action.
Jeff, when it comes into these stages, I mean, it really heats up all the way back through the field.
One more lap, and if Landon Castle holds his line, he may be able to stave off Brad Keselowski and stay on the lead lap. That would benefit Danica Patrick. And Ty Dillon is trying to get another stage point and get past Clint Bowyer.
Yeah, great. The long run car, is that 13 has been really good on the long run.
The end of stage two. Landon Castle sprints ahead of Brad Keselowski, who wins his first stage. And for eighth place, Bowyer out ahead of Ty Dillon on the bottom. Bowyer eighth, Dillon ninth, Logano 10th.
That's what I like. Ages, they fight hard for those positions.
Yes, sir.
They want those playoff points and those stage points.
Well, that'd
be big.
Was that a caution-free stage?
It
Brad
was.
Keselowski, the winner. Let's take a look at Jimmy Johnson's pit stop, and I want you to watch the wall, the pit wall in front of the car as they complete the stop. And right in this area, you'll see what happens as they try to roll both those tires over to the wall, and one gets away.
Yeah, the catcher didn't catch it.
Well, and the carrier is a little bit, you know, sloppy with it as well.
Now,
well, that, yeah,
leaving his pit.
That's coming off the 13.
Denny Hamlin runs over. Looks like somebody on the 13 dropped their radio.
Yeah.
By the way, our graphics showed zero, but Hamlin did get four tires on that pit. XSE pace car hits pit road. Lost a special friend this week. 14-year-old Sarah Bush lost her battle with leukemia. We'll remember her as we go for a NASCAR on Fox. Crank it up at Richmond.
Thank you. clear on the high side. Clear on high, all around. Clear all around, 1842. On your bumper, on your bumper.
One back down bottom,
still clear. Got a run coming to your inside. There you go, still clear, still clear. 42's way up high against the wall here. You're clear, coming outside. Got the run, he's got it, coming outside. After 42, you'll be clear.
Ryan Newman and Dale Earnhardt Jr. were both hoping for a caution before they pitted. They got one. Dale Earnhardt Jr. coming off four.
This is
way up on the outside of the racetrack, or off two, rather. And there's Jimmy Johnson. Bam.
I mean, Jr. gets a little loose on the outside, but he still was up against the wall.
Yeah, I just Jimmy didn't know he was there. Like, I think Jr. came out of nowhere. I don't think Jimmy was expecting it.
Here's Dale Jr. audio.
I have no clue anybody was out there. My apologies.
Or Jimmy Johnson, rather, that was.
Look, of all the people for this to happen to.
But look
where
Junior is. He's way up. He gets in the loose stuff. It slows a little bit, and the car just. I just know Jimmy didn't have any idea that Junior was going to be off that corner.
Riding with Dale Junior.
He knows he's outside from right there.
48. Hey. He's coming there.
I mean, Junior was way up against the wall.
Get down here, say hi. I can't get you down. I cannot get you down. Keep coming, though.
It was all right together in that pack, Vince.
Well, and you guys mentioned three in the top
trouble
six.
Trouble down here, turn four,
there
guys.
You go.
Trouble in three.
88 around.
And it's Junior, and we're getting a caution.
Sorry, guys. I just saw him spinning like crazy.
He's going around like a top.
He was.
Yeah, I bet he cut a tire because the fenders are in on the tires. They tried to clear him out, probably didn't. Get him all the way off of those tires and probably cut a tire.
He goes into three right here, and that thing just goes around and around. Watch this. Around, around she goes.
Oh, that's no fun.
I think I left for a tire, so what didn't do that much. He does a lot.
Come around here. Left rear, Greg.
So pit road is open.
And here come
and will
on.
They all come?
Please.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, all the lead lap cars are in. Matt.
And Brad Keselowski and Paul Wolff said there was no debate because they learned early out in the race what tires meant. No changes on the two.
Now Greg up in turn three, Boyer and Dillon got together. They sorted that out. Started up in turn number three, but Ty Dillon was 16th. Clint Boyer was 19th, and
goodness.
That's how they ended up.
I just can't imagine what could have caused that.
Very suspicious looking. I don't know what happened. I've heard that a lot.
Maybe because the two.
Oh, Matt Kenseth may have cut a tire.
He got a cut tire.
Right rear looks like.
Wow, led 164 laps today. Running in 10th place and now
72, then you come down.
Can't get to pit road.
Get there.
Vince.
Boy, that's adding insult to injury. They had been running up front all day and then just had a bad pit stop, which Matt teamed a kick in the groin. And then they had that issue with the tires. So it's gone from bad to worse for the 20 after a beautiful day early on.
All the air is out.
This was off turn two. Maybe that's why.
Yeah, that's. Right there.
It looked like maybe Truex didn't realize that they were side by side, came up a little bit.
Caution for debris. Four wide into three. My goodness.
Oh, no, he cut it. It cut his tire down.
By Blaney.
I think he cut his tire down.
Yep.
Stay up there. Stop. Stay up there. 41 cut our left rear.
They were not.
The wall pretty good with the right side, right rear first.
I'm surprised they made it that far.
Yeah, there was no give there, but there was a lot of take.
You know, the way these front fenders are flared out, they just seem to catch the edge of those tires, especially early in a run when the pressures are down.
Eighth place here.
Sidewall's pretty vulnerable with the low air pressure. Then you just give it a little nudge.
So Chase Elliott makes a little bit of contact with 41 and Kurt Busch. That sends him up into the left rear. Of Ryan Blaney, you can see Ryan trying his best to hold on to it.
Look like bumper cars.
Pits are open. I want to show you what Joey Logano did. He's the first car coming to pit road. He's going to stay out till the very last instant to turn in. And Kyle Busch can't see for sure where the commitment box is. and goes over it.
Yeah, you've got to have all four tires under that orange box, that little box right there. And if you don't, it's a violation.
Now, what Logano did was completely legal.
Was it intentional?
I don't know.
No, what Logano did was perfect.
Yes.
And to me, there's obviously some confusion for the drivers. If they knew that all four need to be below that box, and I heard that NASCAR told them that in the driver's meeting, but a lot of them didn't hear it, you would be way below that box. You wouldn't even be close to it.
Uncontrolled tire for the 24 of Chase Elliott. He goes to the back for the restart. Here we go. It'll be 19 to go.
19 laps to go in that 42 car out.
First five drivers stayed out. Here comes Logano with tires way down on the inside. He's got grip.
Not so sure we're done seeing cautions yet, guys.
Oh, no, you're
this
not.
Is gonna be
no, it gets ugly these last few laps.
He's inside Buescher and Truex for third place.
How about how this race has come to Joey Logano? I mean, it is in his hands right now. Fresh tires. Now he's got the track position coming to him.
Yeah, all that three wide stuff, you can get away with that early on in the race, middle of the race, because you'll give and take. But once you get down to this point, you got to just take, no give.
Boy, Harvick had a run, but Stenhouse holds him back, and McMurray is right there to challenge.
Yeah,
here comes Logano off turn four. The white flag waves. One lap to go, sponsored by Credit One Bank. Still, Harvick, Stenhouse, side by side. McMurray right with them. Joey Logano, eight car lengths ahead of Keselowski, who stuffs it into turn three, cuts it down to five car lengths, but off turn four, Joey Logano has his 18th Monster Energy Series victory, beating teammate Brad Keselowski by 3/4 of a second.
Hell yeah.
You see,
great job, guys. Great
see Joey
job.
Show off a little bit as he's sideways across the line.
When you get it done, we give you an opportunity, you make it happen. Hell yeah.
Away from his teammate Brad Keselowski, and Logano, whose last win was Phoenix last November, nine starts ago.
There's somebody not real happy the way things ended up.
And that would be most everybody?
Most everybody,
not named,
especially
Joey Logano.
Kyle Busch.
No, we were watching Kyle Busch. He looked like he's in a hurry to catch up with somebody, but I think he's in a hurry to get out of the car.
Yeah, he wants to talk to somebody, all right, but I don't think it's anybody driving the race car.
Joey Logano, the seventh driver to win in 2017, started in the back due to a transmission change. And Joey taking the checkered flag is today's Sunoco fueling victory.
Well, you can question whether Joey Logano was the best car today, but you cannot question his ability to do burnouts. He's very impressive with those donuts, burnouts.
Caught for the violation, it certainly took him out of the chance to win. He was asked about it moments ago by our Chris Neville.
Kyle, any chance we can talk to you about that pit violation there?
Balls and strikes.
With Michael Waltrip, Chris Myers referencing a judgment call by NASCAR. Clearly, we saw the tires on that orange
you
area.
Can't have any part of your right side tires hit that orange square. He couldn't see clearly when he went to go to pit road because Joey Logano waited so late to turn in, but he did make a violation.
So the winner, Joey Logano, let's head to victory lane.
It is a celebration indeed for Joey Logano and this 22 team at Team Penske in his 300th Cup Series start. He goes from worst to first and then to victory lane. You told me before the race, boy, you got to be patient in this one. And then at the end, you had to go. What makes this one so special?
Oh, man, just coming from the back for one, being a 300th start. To bring this Shell Penzel forward into victory lane. Man, that feels really good. I'm shaving my guts out there. That's all I had. We won with a car that may have not been in the winning car, so that's something to be very proud of as a team. That means execution was there, and we were able to put ourselves in position to, man, I'm out of breath. race there at hard at the end. Brad was the fastest car. He was so fast, and we had a good restart to be able to get enough cushion, but he was catching me a couple tenths a lap there at the end. I was running so hard, but obviously can't do this without Roush Yates, AAA Auto Trader, Wheels Up, Coca-Cola, SKF, AutoZone. Everybody helps out this Team Penske organization. A nice 1-2 finish, that feels good. I think there's four fours in the top five. That's something to be proud of as well. So Good, good. It's nice to finally break through and get a win.
Congratulations, well deserved. Joey Logano wins at Richmond.
Matt. Car for the two team and Brad Keselowski. But did the finish actually come down to the second to last stop and how you stayed out? Maybe that might have jumbled up track position a little bit.
Yeah, I don't know. I felt like we'd have been fine. Just, you know, that last restart there was about six or seven cars that stayed out, and we got behind one that was really slow and didn't really go. So we lost two or three spots by the time we could get going. And by then, Joey was gone. I think really what we needed is about 10 more laps. I wish this was a Richmond 410 or four, I'd take a 500, but it was a really good effort. We had a ton of long run speed, just those short runs at the end. We weren't good enough to pass cars on a short run. We were good enough to kind of hold serve and then go on the long runs, and just kept getting all those yellows at the end, Matt, and couldn't make anything of it with the Detroit Genuine Parts Ford. But happy for my teammate, for Team Penske to get a 1-2. Certainly wanted to win, but a lot better than what we were in practice, and really pleased with the speed and the effort today. Didn't quite get all the breaks we needed to fall our way, so that's how it goes sometimes.
And it was a weekend sweep for the captain, Roger Penske, won over an IndyCar and then here today in NASCAR.
We checked the standings. You win, you're in. Kyle Larson continues to be the points leader. Logano with his first victory of the year. His teammate has won twice. Jimmy Johnson has won twice. At this time last year, Michael Waltrip, Joe Gibbs Racing had won five of the first nine races. They have zero wins so far.
Great performance by the cars today and last week in Bristol, but no result.
Well, Dale's first race after announcing retirement this week. And Dale, it kind of sounded like an up and down day, but the second half of the race, it seemed like you were making improvements on the car. Saw you talking to Jimmy Johnson there. What happened?
He said he didn't see us. he had pitted and got tires. He was out there running around the top and weren't ready to pit yet. And he said, you know, didn't get any notice that he had a car outside. So he was coming to pass me. I was running the top right against the fence and really wasn't watching the mirror. So I didn't even know he was there or anybody was coming. TJ was giving me pretty good warning about guys getting on my inside. And but otherwise, when you're running the top, you don't have to worry about it. They kind of take care, you know, everybody kind of takes care of you. But Jimmy didn't know he was there. Came off the corner and didn't know the car was there. So it was an explosion. But the car held up pretty well. It knocked a sway bar arm off of it, so we run the last bit of the race without a sway bar hooked up. But wasn't a great day. We did make a lot of adjustments, and that last run, I was pretty happy. And obviously, we were trying a pretty wild strategy, staying out. And I was pretty comfortable it was going to work because our lap times were pretty decent, and everybody else was coming to us that had pitted, so it wasn't going to be too bad. Just terrible luck. I don't know what to do, you know, but we were probably going to finish anywhere around from 10th to 15th today. Not all that awesome, but, you know, we just had such terrible luck.
And Talladega is next. Thanks, Dale.